This edition of Computer Club Lesson was recorded on January the 9th, 2017. Today we're going to look at how the world is being attacked. Hello, welcome to Computer Club Lesson. This episode is brought to you by the Binary Guys. Time to start once again.
Everyone's holidays.
Yeah. I have an announcement to make here. My health over the last little while has declined somewhat from what it should be. And I've had issues now for quite a while, 6 months or so. And it's come to the point now where it's getting really difficult for me to do these once a week. So what's going to happen is next week we will have one, and then thereafter it will be every 2 weeks. I'll send you out emails on when we're ready to go, what the next date will be, and all of that stuff. So I'll keep you well informed of what's going on. But for now, that's the situation as it stands. So hopefully this is not going to get any worse than it already is, and I will be able to keep going with once every 2 weeks.
Okay.
All right, James is going to start off. He wants to tell you a little bit about what happened to him over Christmas. So James, let you go.
Oh man, a lot of things happened.
Poutine hacked you, that's what happened.
Where should I begin? Well, it all started long ago on Christmas. I was at my grandparents' place, and I was looking something on my phone to like prove something or just find something. And the last time we were here, we talked about the pop-up spyware and scumware and things that tell you, oh, you're infected, install this, or call us now and give us money, and it'll be okay. So I was looking up some information. I got attacked by one on my phone. And I'm like, hey, Grandpa, it just happened. So this, essentially, the page redirected me to us.affairw.top. Which I don't even know what that is.
Did you go there?
No. It just redirected me there. And it says, your system is heavily damaged by 4 viruses. We detect that your Samsung Galaxy J3 Duos, which this is what my phone is 28.1% damaged because of 4 harmful viruses from recent adult sites, which I haven't been on. Soon it will damage your phone's SIM card and will corrupt your contacts, photos, data, applications, etc. If you do not remove the virus now, it will cause severe damage to your phone. Here's what you need to do, step by step. Step 1, tap the button and install AppLock for free on Google Play. That's it, one step. That's all there was on it. I'm like, okay, hold on here. I haven't been on any adult sites. I wasn't even going to an adult site. And why would I install an app lock for whatever I have? It's a simple solution.
Let's be certain sure that this is an app lock. In other words, if he installed it, it would lock all his apps.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so the name is app lock. So I'm just like, now hold on a second. I haven't even used this phone. That was the first time I went on the internet. And it came up. I'm like, now something's not right here. But yeah.
It was fun then.
Oh yeah, it was very fun for me. I was having a good laugh. But I didn't go too far with it because I didn't want to actually install the thing. But With phones, it's a lot trickier to get out of that because the phones save where your last place that you went to. So anytime I turned on the internet again, it brought me right back to this page. I'm like, well, I don't want to be here. So I had to eventually, the moment I started, I quickly smashed my home button. So it takes me back to google.com. And it got me out of that. I hadn't had any problems since.
Okay, hang on, James.
Hang on.
You got a problem here.
What's my problem? Did that...
The microphone turned itself off.
Oh, good. I have to repeat myself?
No.
Oh, okay. Just subtitle it.
You've told your story, and that's the best we can do. Okay?
Man, I wanted the whole world to see it.
I know that's what you wanted, but that's not what you got. I dropped that mic, so I don't know whether it's still working.
Do you want me to yell at it?
I want you to do something because it's not working.
Oh. Drop it again. That one fixes it.
Just throw it across the room. We don't need this. Also,
something happened to it.
Okay, what would have your technical difficulties here?
All right, there it is.
Back up.
Okay, James, you've done your best, but you've kind of messed up, so.
You and Mariah Carey. You and Mariah Carey have trouble in her New Year's.
Yeah,
ooh.
That's so much
about it. Never mind.
Forget that I like. You guys are here. I'm down here at the age spectrum. What?
All right, never mind. Go sit somewhere.
Yeah. Out in the hall.
You're being punished.
Out in the hall.
That's a long time out now.
Okay, I better do this again. In case I have to. Okay, isn't this a wonderful looking screen up on what we have here? This screen is showing you all of the attacks that are taking place in the world on the internet. It's showing you what's being attacked, who's being attacked, where the attacks are coming from, and what time it's happening. It's all very, very interesting. There's a dozen or so sites like this on the internet that shows you what's happening on the internet in real time. A lot of these attacks, if you look over here in this attack type, you will see that the attack is SMTP. Anybody? SMTP?
Yeah,
Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. In other words, email. Right? And so email servers are being attacked every second worldwide. There isn't an email server on the planet, I've said this before, that has not been compromised in one way or another. And these compromises usually wind up dumping all of the email addresses that the email server is currently holding. And so, if you make a new email address for yourself, within 20 minutes, you could start receiving spam. Okay? Within 20 minutes. Because somewhere along the line, that server will be attacked and it will dump all of the email addresses that it is currently holding. And yours will be among them. Isn't that sweet? If you look over here, under the attacker, in other words, who's sending this stuff out, you will find things like China and the Philippines and Symantec and lots and lots of Microsoft. Some Google, but not a lot. It's in there. And usually you'll find a good mix of internet service providers. And so when we say the attacker, in this instance, what we're saying is that these entities have been co-opted in one way or another. Now, for Microsoft, yes, some of it is coming from Redmond, Washington, where Microsoft lives, but a lot of it is just simply coming from Microsoft servers. And so the server identifies itself as Microsoft, and that's why you see it in this list as Microsoft. The same holds true for internet service providers, Cox Communications, as an example, comes up on here a lot. Clearwire Communications, ClearNet, a lot of them are United States based.
Is that all happening live right now?
This is happening live as we're looking at it. So you can see that a lot of this network traffic is internal inside the United States and Canada, Mexico. Some of it is getting shot up from South America, but a good deal of it is coming from China. Okay? And a good deal of it is coming from Ukraine and Estonia and Russia, the Russian sphere of influence. Okay? In other words, the Russian hackers. That's who they are.
All of our friends, yeah.
Yeah, all of our friends in Russia. There are some coming from Africa, in places where the internet has made great inroads, and one of them is Nigeria, another one is Somalia. Okay? And so you're going to find a lot of stuff coming in from them. But as you can see from this map, the biggest part of it is coming from China and then internally from the United States itself. But you'll see, if you watch carefully, these arrows coming from China and Europe heading the United States, all of a sudden, bang, they start to go back to where they came from. Well, that's just the internet communicating with itself. So, something comes in from China, hits Redmond, Washington. Redmond, Washington replies back to China, saying, yes, I'm here. Okay? It's just acknowledging that it's there.
Can you stop it from doing that?
No. No. It's not going to stop. It's not going to stop.
Are the colors for any?
Yeah. Some of the colors.
Colors indicate what the type is.
Yeah. What the type of attack is, and you can see them in this list as you're going by. SMTP attacks. RSH attacks, HTTP attacks, that's the web, Telnet attacks, that's another piece of the web. They're all in this list here. If you can freeze the list, you'd see, but it's going by so fast. The other attack types are listed here, the most common type, and the most common is SMTP. Okay, the next most common is Telnet. Now, Telnet is a way that the internet communicates through plain text. Okay, you can bring up a window that looks for all the world like a command line window, a black window. But you can bring it up as what we call Telnet, and you can start sending commands by hand through Telnet, and the commands will, without the filter of HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol, will just go somewhere and do stuff. Okay, that's the most favorite type. XM file system and MySQL are another one of the top types of attack. MySQL and SQL type servers work with internet servers, the HTTP server that, say, Google has or Microsoft has that serves you resources. Part of that is MySQL or an SQL type server. And that server holds information on how the internet should talk to you directly. Okay? So if you send, if you have a Microsoft account and you send a Microsoft, you log on to Microsoft, or you log on to your computer and the computer logs on to Microsoft, it's going to send back its everything it knows about you from Redmond through an SQL service, okay? A SQL service. So it's sending this SQL stuff along with the hypertext transfer protocol. That's why it's so important to understand that it is an attack vector. Right now, as of this minute, the attacks from in-country coming, most of them are from the United States internally, and the rest of them, or a good deal of them, are coming from China. You can see that here. Okay. Now, when we say these attacks are coming internal, I've got another one here I can bring up, which will show you again these types and where they're coming from. Now this is a little bit slower, but it's also showing you the malware that's running on the systems, and you can see that there are worms, and if you know what you're looking for by names of worms and stuff like that, and malware by name, okay, they're in this list. And I can see them going through as Trojan Droppers and Trojan Banker and on Win32 Trojans and on fake Trojans. On and on it goes. The Zeus Trojan. Okay? We cannot stop these things. What it's really telling you is that every computer that you see sending stuff is infected with this Trojan, or with this malware, okay? And it's working itself in real time. It's also working itself in real space. By that I mean that single PC type computers infected with these types of malware every few minutes, every few seconds, send out requests for information to their central servers. Okay? So if a computer in Mexico has been harmed with one of these, and say it's Trojan Banker, then somewhere from Finland or Turkey or China, a request will come to this Mexican computer saying, dump all your stuff. Tell me what you found out. Did this guy log onto his bank? What's the password? All right? That's what you're seeing here. In real time, these requests are coming over the internet to these various places that have computers that have been infected by this malware, and you can see them now. They're all starting to now talk back to Europe, to Russia, to the Russian sphere of influence, to Turkey, to Vietnam and China, to South America, and even internally to themselves. Okay? Isn't this fun? No. I just sit and look at this for hours.
Now, this wasn't meant to scare you. I know we do a lot of things that are scary, and we don't do it on purpose.
But we do.
Does this include the military, Bob? Is that a separate link?
That's something quite separate. When you get attacks in specific places in the United States, particularly around this area here, which is Colorado, where most of the military type computers are, Colorado and Washington. But if you see them headed off towards Colorado, okay, they're attacking military installations.
What did they do when they attacked?
They're looking for that vulnerability where these malwares have gotten themselves installed on the computer. Okay, let's talk about the stuff that's been in the news the last couple of days. How many of you are watching news? Okay, yes, I know. Okay, but what they've been talking about in the last couple of days is how the American election system or American political parties were compromised. And it was simple. Some stoop touched something he shouldn't have touched, and his computer was compromised. Okay? The guy's a dope. And he even asked somebody, is this okay? And the dope on the other end of the phone said, yeah, go ahead.
Sounds like me.
Does having a malware protect us from some of this? I mean, having malware?
Yeah, some of it you will be protected from. Now look, what you're seeing here is when it's really, really busy on this map, you might see 24 things. Okay? But there are millions and millions and millions of computers that are infected with malware of this type. Okay, this is just giving you an overview of what's happened.
Also, can we just point out, yesterday there was 3.9 million attacks yesterday, and today since midnight is 2.8 million.
2.8, the day's not over. This is the weekend, okay? Everybody's at work.
No one's interested in Hamilton.
Every once in a while, you'll see something open up here about where Toronto is. Okay. Every once in a while, something will open up about where Calgary is. And the other place that will open up is Redmond, Washington, and Vancouver is very close.
But I've noticed a pattern with this so far. I know that it's random, but I noticed a pattern. Nothing attacks Canada. It's always Canada. Like you see, is attacking itself.
Yeah, pretty much Canada is attacking itself. And that's
just see the Lego.
Yeah. And that's where you see this. Okay. Now, a lot of this stuff you'll see is coming out of the Netherlands and Finland. Okay, and it's going on to the Philippines and India. I think what you're seeing here, really, in that instance, is just Russia, Finland, Romania are just answering back to these computers here in North America, South America, that have requested information from their botnet servers. Okay, most of the botnet servers are in Europe. Most of the computers that will require information from those botnet servers are in North America, South America, some in Africa, a good deal of them in the Philippines.
How is this program actually set up to monitor this?
Okay, hundreds and hundreds of other computers from around the world, from Checkpoint Services software, are monitoring the internet traffic as it goes through servers, okay? And so they look at the first couple of lines of the code that's going through the server and determining, number one, where it came from and where it's going. The next thing it looks at is the first couple of lines of the actual program, and from that it can divine whether that information that's going past it is malware, spyware, scumware, or just regular traffic of videos and mail and documents and such like that. Okay, so it's pretty smart that way, but there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of servers around the world with all of these companies that check this stuff out. They need to know. They are the ones that are trying to protect us. Now, they're trying to do it for a price. You know, if you want the protection, you have to pay. But for us and for them as a selling tool, they open this stuff up and say, look at this, folks. This is what's happening in real time. We can help you with this, but it's going to cost you. Okay?
That's what that checkpoint does?
Yeah, Checkpoint is one of the major business-to-business software protection companies in the world. There are others, Kaspersky, Symantec. They do large bits of business-to-business stuff. And really, now it's not so much of late that these attacks on personal computers by personal people like yourselves are the real target. The real target is business. Okay? That's where the money is. That's where the money's kept. That's where the money is flowing through. Intercept that, and you've got more of a chance to get money quickly than from your home PC. So, are you a target? You are less likely to be a target than a business that's a block away from you. And when we say business, we're usually talking about big business. Communications companies. Banking institutions. Anything that has to do with money. Hospitals. Anything that has to do with record keeping, because in those records will be records of how money moves. And all of that kind of stuff, which is truly business to business, that's what these things are really monitoring, not the computer in your house.
So who reads all this millions of tons of paper?
At some point or other, the attackers themselves, let's say they're in Estonia, stop their attack and they look at the logs that their computers have produced about who they attacked and what was the result. And they can download this information from their servers and look at it carefully and say, okay, there's a way in. We did a small attack on this server, this business, and it shows this vulnerability. There's a way in. And so they start working on that way in, whether it's through phishing attacks or whether it's just simply going to that server and banging on it for a little while to make it fail so that they can get in. That's how it's done. In a lot of cases, unless the bad guys are going for something really, really specific. Last year there was a really, really specific attack that got them a lot of money. And that was the attack on a bank in Saudi Arabia. Think about it for a minute. Okay, you want to know where the money is? Saudis have it. And so there was a really specific attack on a Saudi bank. And over the course of about a week or so, the malefactors worked their way into the banking system that was the target, and they very carefully went through the servers and found where they could transfer money safely, quietly, out of that bank into their own bank. With a few jumps to hide what they've been doing, they might have jumped some of this from where they were, Estonia, they might have jumped it into the United States and then back into Turkey and then back into Somalia and back into Estonia where they were, okay? Hide their trail as best they can. That's doable. Was the attack sophisticated? You bet. How much money did they get? Gobs and gobs and gobs and gobs. Nobody really knows. But when they got past a couple of hundred million, they stopped counting. And they figured it was a guy, you know, it's a ring of about a dozen people that were involved in this, sitting in an office somewhere in Estonia with the latest computers and the latest hacking software, pounding on this Saudi bank until it failed. That let them in.
They're techies like you, though.
Yeah. Only a lot better at it than I am. A lot better at it than I am.
Can we remote that site and look, I'm sorry, and look at it?
No.
Oh, no, you can.
Yeah.
No.
So if they hack Amazon.com and they say all the people this Christmas who have ordered stuff and all those people have PayPal accounts, you do become the target then.
Yeah, you become a target, but through a larger organization than just yourself.
It is a connection. Yeah.
Now the yes, I don't know how many phishing emails my wife has gotten over the last week or so, but she tells me every time, and every time I have to get up and go and have a look. So I know that over the last week or so it's been quite a few. I haven't been keeping track, but phishing emails about her PayPal account. She doesn't have one. Okay. Log into your PayPal account and change your password, please. Use this link to do it. Click the button. Okay. If you think your PayPal account or any account that you have money in has been compromised and you're not sure, do not click the button. That button will take you to the hacker's webpage, which for all the world will look like your bank site, will look like PayPal or any place else that it says that you must look at. Amazon, you must look at. No, go to the site by typing it in, paypal.com. Okay? And when it comes up, try and log in with your credentials. If it's not going to let you in, there will be a way for you to reauthorize your credentials, okay, through an email or whatever. But do not click on that button. That button will take you somewhere else. All right. How have we done here? Anybody want to go back to the other site and see what's going on there again?
Did you have a good Christmas, Bob?
I had a fantastic one.
Seriously, if I type www.nos.com, do I get that?
James told me, and the only way I got it was that you have to search for Norse Corp and then map, and you click on that and it'll take you here. But if you go to norsecorp.com, you can't find the map.
Well, it's a big button when you first start up that says, look at my map.
Yeah?
Yeah. You could just, well, I don't know where you were. Yeah. You were you were in the same ballpark.
It's, I don't know why it's not loading, but it's not. Oh, here we go.
It just takes a while.
But the best way to find these is just search live. Attack, live cyber attack maps, and you can get a whole slew of them.
Yep.
There's some which essentially make music with the hacks.
That's cool.
So I was trying to find that one, and I thought this was it, but I was wrong. But there's one that just chimes, like, any, depending what attack it is a different octave. So each attack would be nothing but chimes. And it's just really good to just look at it and be like, yep, this is the world.
Yeah, this is the world as we live it today. And as I've been questioned about, no, there is nothing you can do about it.
Well, if it's Australia, they're really tough to Australia. Is there a reason for that?
Where's that?
Australia.
Yeah.
You know, down there, hanging at the bottom.
Okay. Yeah, Australia gets dinged every once in a while, but you got to remember that Australia is tomorrow. Things that are crossing the international dateline.
Yeah.
Okay. It gets all strange and funny.
Oh.
Australia is tomorrow. Australia is the future.
Yeah.
So it gets a little nuts and a little funny when things start going to Australia. You'll notice that Australia is not set at its proper place on the map. It's sitting here below Indonesia. Okay, that's not the case. It's in the middle of the Pacific, way over there.
I just want to point out with old maps, I hate every single map because it makes the Pacific Ocean look smaller than what it is. The Pacific Ocean's the biggest ocean.
Yeah.
And like, if you dig a hole straight down, you will pop out in the Pacific Ocean again. That's how big it is. But old maps just like, now let's cut this out and just crop these together.
Yeah.
Well, even the Atlantic.
Even the Atlantic's pretty big.
They've got South America nearly touching Africa.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, this map is even worse.
These maps are... see, there you go. It went to Australia.
They're not. Being honest.
But you can see from this map that
a lot more activity happens.
There is a lot more activity happening here, and it's going a lot more from continent to continent. What they're looking at, we would have to dig down really, really hard and see what programs are being used to do this. It's not really saying what programs are being used for these attacks. You just see them as an attack. Okay, any other questions about attacks? Yes, your computer itself can be compromised to join up what we call a botnet. Okay, a robot network, botnet. And your computer will talk to these botnets all by itself. And I've never talked about mesh computing, so I'm just going to give you a little quick primer on what mesh computing is. But mesh computing is where you take a bunch of computers and you link them together, either with software or hardware. So if you could fit 100 computers in this room, you could link them together through one wire with software or through 100 wires. And then they become what we call a mesh network. You can take one of those computers and take it to Africa, plop it down there, and it's still part of the mesh. Take another one to the North Pole and plop it down there, and it's still part of the mesh. Mesh networks are expandable by geography. Botnets are expandable by programming. So mesh networks are the desired kind of them because they are expandable by geography. And so when you start up a mesh network, by definition, you are starting up a network in the whole world, not just locally, you know, within 10 miles of where you are, but it can be the whole world. And so a lot of these malware programs, when they attack a computer, what they really want to do is make that computer part mesh network. In other words, join it to geography, not just programming, but geography. And the more, the bigger the mesh network, one, the faster it is, the more robust it is. It becomes an internet of its own. I think a couple of years ago, I showed you how the internet in the early days was put together, computer by computer. It was all done by hand. You sat at a keyboard and you typed in all of the things that you needed to tell the computer on the other end, you're part of my network now, let's talk. This is all done by software now. Install the software on a computer at the other end of your connection, and it makes those connections for you. In a heartbeat, it makes them. It doesn't take half a day, just in a heartbeat, the connection is done. And there it is, part of this mesh network.
It must be tea time.
Yeah, they're all taking a coffee break.
No, it stops here every once in a while. I don't know why. Try hitting the unpause button. There seems to be a pause button in the control.
Sure. Oh, okay. I see. In there.
Look more of a sound.
You broke it.
Oh, we've been hacked. There's no way.
Let's go get something else.
There's a fog.
Somebody beating up on the door?
Yeah, I'm trying to open it. I had a key to it now.
Anyway, so there you go. That's our real time attack map. Network. Now, do we have questions about other stuff? Did everybody get stuff for Christmas?
No new stuff. Except James.
Yeah.
It went wrong anyway.
I got a lot of new stuff.
Can we play with your new stuff?
Yeah. Can you handle it?
I don't know. We'll find out.
I mean, I was thinking like, let's teach everyone that. VR and how to use VR, and Graham's like, no. I'm like, well, there goes my fun.
What's VR?
Virtual reality.
Oh, God. How can we deal with this reality?
Yeah, we have enough trouble with this reality.
Yes. Yeah.
Virtual reality will make you sick.
Possibly, yes.
Yes, it's like sitting on a spinning chair. You will throw up.
It's nauseating. I have a problem then if you're in the kitchen.
You get stuff in the village,
you know,
that makes us sick.
You click on the white bar at the top.
Huh? Yeah,
you get stuff in the village that makes us sick, right?
I stopped doing that and I don't know why. It will not make half a screen, it just minimizes. And
okay. So, where you want to click on is
there,
right
in
the middle of the bar.
I do it the same as I've been doing it for.
Okay.
First showed us a couple of months ago.
Hold down your mouse button.
Hold down the mouse button, yeah.
Now, if you drag the mouse over to the corner, it will give you a quarter of the screen.
No, don't
okay.
do that, no.
Don't do that?
No, it minimizes it and leaves it sitting right in the middle, just as if I'd minimized the screen.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And it just started doing that. About a week ago.
I don't know that.
Oh. Why do you always have the interesting problems that,
is that
we've
interesting?
Never, that we've never seen
before?
What are you doing to your computer to get these problems?
Is it doing it with every program or just your web browser?
I do not know.
because you can do this with every program you have.
I'm doing it. My PC, so that I can move it over,
okay,
then open pictures, so as I can make
yeah.
a disk with pictures. Except it won't. My PC
yeah.
won't do it
yeah.
now.
See this. This is another program
yeah.
entirely. I can make it do the same thing here.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you open up
yeah.
my PC all the way, full screen?
That's what I get, yes.
Okay. Have you tried doing it this way by having the window less than full screen?
No, that's what I end up with.
Okay, well let's try what you end up with is where you want to be. Okay, so if you do this, if you drag it over, you should get that. If you start with, if you start with this,
okay.
if the window is less than full screen, give it a try and let me know whether that solves the problem of it being, if you drag the window to the top of the screen corner, okay, you will get one quarter of the screen, like that.
Yeah, no,
okay.
It's not even doing that. Just,
I have another thing you can try. Let me see if the, I still remember though.
Thank you.
So, if the mouse isn't working, try holding the Windows key. The square, four squares.
Yeah.
And hit the right arrow key, or the left arrow key.
Oh, okay.
Or the up arrow key.
Okay.
Yeah, try your arrow keys, they may work.
Okay.
But you have to hold down
the Windows
key. So try that, let us know.
Yes, I will.
And if it does start to work, that may solve the problem. The computer may just have forgotten how to handle a mouse. That may solve the problem for the mouse. All right, that was a wonderful question. Any more wonderful questions? Yes.
Yeah, was that problem there? She was a shutter, just unplugged the computer and plugged it back in. Was that correct, that problem?
Probably not.
In fact, it would probably do worse.
It may do some damage if you did.
Right.
Forget that.
Let me just quickly explain why that wouldn't work and why. When you open up a window full screen like this and then shut it down with the X and then open it up again, why it goes back to full screen? Or if you have it less than full screen and you shut it down and you open it up again, it opens in less than full screen.
Memorizing.
It's memorizing the last thing it did. And it's memorizing it in the registry. There's a little piece of the registry that tells the computer where every icon is, what makes up the icon, you know, what texture makes up the icon. When the icon is open, what size is it? Where is it located? If I move this around over here, and I shut it down and then open it back up again, it will open right there in that memory shift. So it's remembering about all of this. And that's maybe part of your problem. It has forgotten how to remember.
You're so old now.
No, it's
new. I would think that you have a very old computer then.
So this is part of the registry. One of the things that can get you into trouble, but one of the things that is extremely helpful is if your computer has misbehaved so badly that it's locked completely. I've told you before, hold down the power button until it quits. It takes 3 or 4 seconds, but you'll hear it go click and the thing goes black. Okay, that's not a good thing to do because it doesn't have a chance to remember what this screen was doing. It just, boom, there's no power. It just goes away. So when you try and open it again, you may have problems because it can't remember what it was doing the last time you closed it. Okay. When you click on power down, the power button shut down. Okay. The reason it takes so long, it takes a number of seconds for the computer to go to power down mode, is that it is it's redoing everything that it knows about. What windows were open, what icons were where, what has to be saved, and what you can close without saving. All of that stuff, that's why it takes a few seconds. But if you do that with the power button, just hold it till you don't get any of that. And that can, it can give you real problems, but sometimes it's the only way. A hard shutdown. And then when you shut it back, open it back up again, you're back in business, or you shouldn't.
When you shut it down, it says, you know, closing all apps, and it tells you, you know, and you just say, okay, I'll just sit and wait for it. Yeah. You know,
And sometimes an app will hang, and it will tell you, I can't close this right away. It's waiting, but eventually it does close, and you're good.
Also, I just remember now, we tried to get Sandboxy to work.
Sandbox.
It doesn't work anymore with Windows 10.
I
use it all the time.
Windows 10?
Yeah.
When you open it, you open Sandbox IE, is it opening Internet Explorer, the E? Or is it opening Chrome? Or is it opening...
Not Chrome. It's Internet Explorer.
It's Internet Explorer, this E right here?
I believe so.
Okay, because Sandbox IE does not work very well with Edge. Okay?
You know what, I get this MSN page that comes up. I have Firefox pinned to my start.
Yeah.
And when I start, I go to my icon for Sandboxy, which comes up and then it says 1, 2, 3 seconds.
As it should.
But then my Firefox window comes up, but behind it, there's MSN.
Okay.
So
right.
I try
yeah.
to delete it, but it knocks out my Sandbox.
Yeah, yeah. In Windows 10, Sandbox IE sort of works. That's why I'm not recommending that everybody go to it, because there are some real problems with Sandbox IE in Windows 10. Windows 7, it worked great.
Well, you know what? Every now and again, it'll come up and it'll say, do you want to get rid of all that's in your Sandbox?
Yeah.
And like, I'll have 200 things in there.
Yeah.
And I just delete it and it seems to start over, so I take it that it's working fine.
Yeah, it's working fine. After you installed Sandbox, you needed to go to the settings in Sandbox and tell it to dump everything every time Sandbox closes. And when I say Sandbox closes, that means that when you shut the computer down, it empties Sandbox. But it's not doing that. It's just hanging on to the stuff. So every once in a while, it'll tell you, I got lots here. Do you want to get rid of this crap?
Yeah.
And that's fine. That's fine to have it that way. So Sandbox IE, I'm not recommending it. I don't know whether they will ever go back. Sandbox IE will
gives me
ever,
updates. I just updated it again just here.
Yeah. I don't know whether it will update itself to the point where it will work well with Windows 10, but even on the Sandbox IE site, there's a whole page of stuff that Sandbox IE just can't do in Windows 10 that it did with no problems in Windows 7. So that's why I'm not recommending it. I'll keep an eye on that. If they do a rewrite of the program and make it work well, especially with Edge, because your computer, when you load,
I have have edge.
Yeah.
I think it's a solar.
Yeah, yeah, it's that's yeah. that solar. That if you you if your computer, if it updated itself to Windows 10, or even if you bought it as a Windows 10 machine,
yeah.
Edge is the default web browser. Now you can find these other ones and use them. And if you know what you're doing, you can change your default web browser to Chrome or to Internet Explorer. You can change it. But for the most part, the default web browser is Edge, and it does not work well in.
I got a thing about Edge the other day saying how much better it is than Chrome.
Yeah, you're going to get that. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. And they save, want you to save use your it. Battery.
Yeah.
And
they want you to use it.
Yeah.
And that's just propaganda. I'm as yet unconvinced.
So you think Chrome is better than Edge?
I do. For the simple reason that as we're talking about sandboxed programs, Chrome has the better technology to sandbox the browser when it's open in the computer. Okay, Edge has sandboxing technology, but it's not as good as Chrome. At least I don't think so.
So I should get rid of my Edge on there?
No, no, leave it. Leave it.
Well, you can anyways.
Why would you use Chrome?
Well, I use Chrome all the time because I believe it is a safer browser than using a Microsoft product, which allows for what we've talked about year after year after year, and that is DirectX. Okay, DirectX is the technology that Microsoft uses to take over your computer and install programs or update programs. But somebody else can use DirectX if they know how to get at it.
No, you're
and
thinking,
take
no, you're
over your computer
ActiveX.
Completely.
You're thinking of ActiveX.
ActiveX, I'm
DirectX
sorry.
DirectX is from video games.
Yeah, ActiveX. Thank you. So it allows for your computer to be taken over your laptop, your desktop, thinks that the computer on the other end of that DirectX
ActiveX
connection is God. It will do whatever it says. And so if a bad guy has tricked you into that kind of access, they have complete control of your computer. And that's why I prefer Chrome, because it does not have that technology.
If I put in Chrome, does it automatically replace what's in?
No. No.
So
it does not. Not in Windows 10.
So what do I have to do to get rid of it?
Oh, you don't want to get rid of it. You just want to stop using it.
I see. So it would stop automatically then?
Well, no, it won't stop automatically. I mean, if you have the E down here in your taskbar, all you have to do is right-click on it and unpin it from the taskbar. It'll disappear. But it will still be available to you in your menu, okay? It will, there's Microsoft Edge right there. It'll still be available.
And just like Internet Explorer, Microsoft Edge cannot be uninstalled.
Yeah, you can't uninstall it, but you can ignore it.
She'll just get the message, won't she, that if she clicks on Edge, and that's what you use, it'll just suddenly say, this is not your default. Do you want it?
It doesn't do that anymore.
And the other thing about Edge, why you might still want to keep it, is that in some instances, videos don't play very well in Chrome. Okay, the default language for an internet browser now in Edge, the default language is what we call HTML5, and that is a programming language that allows for videos to play smoothly in an internet browser. And Edge is the standard for that, not Chrome. So if you have a video on a web page that's not playing smoothly and you really want to see it, open it up in Edge and it will work properly.
Yeah, I open my email in Edge because people send me videos,
yeah,
and it works better than Google.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
But sometimes Google just, it just sits there blank,
yeah,
page.
Exactly so. Exactly
so.
There's my point.
One to the other. Like,
yes.
It's choice.
If we go back to the start menu there where you say they're shut down.
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. When I start up my computer, I have to put up my password in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And when it shuts down by itself, I have to redo the password again.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, instead of going back to sign in, there's a little button on the right-hand side that it says that I can shut down from there without going back in.
Yeah.
Would that be one of the reasons why my internet keeps shutting down? Because I haven't shut it down the right way?
Maybe that's behind us.
In other words, you lose the connection.
Yeah. Remember where I lost it and
yeah,
restored it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not sure, but that's not a reason.
That's not a reason, eh?
No. No.
Okay.
I'm not sure why you keep losing it.
And I keep losing it now, but it is reconnecting every time right now.
Yeah.
But I'm still losing it.
Like in the middle of whatever you're doing.
Yeah.
It will just stop.
It'll stop and I'll have to go to the side and reconnect and like...
I see what you're saying. Yeah. I don't know. It could be that the wireless hardware inside your computer is failing. That means that you'll have to go up and see Allie and get one of these.
Okay.
And then reconnect it.
Okay. No, I just kind of wondered if it was because I was shutting it down
yeah,
the other way.
I know that when we first got that computer for you, and you brought it home from Allie's, and you couldn't get a connection.
Right.
That was one of the reasons was that we were considering that perhaps
the wireless component of the computer was damaged in some way. And so we put one of these little dongles on it just to make sure, and it worked right away. It worked fine. So I would say that maybe what you want to do is get one of these little dongles, just plug it in and use that all the time.
What do you call on that thing?
USB wireless.
Yeah, USB wireless dongle.
USB wireless dongle.
I remember you telling me that with my computer too, and I
yeah,
gave you my computer that it was low. My Wi-Fi seemed to be low within the computer itself.
Yeah.
You said, you know, I've never gotten a dongle because everything works fine, but
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, there we are, folks. That's the end of our hour. It's been a slice. Now I'm gonna say this once again, that we're going to do one next week, and then ever after that it will be every 2 weeks. But I will send you emails to remind you that that we have a class coming up. Not that we're not doing a class, that we have a class coming up.
Awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Thank you so much, everyone. That's Computer Club Listen for today. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.